Hello and welcome to the Bug Fair Connected. The Natural History Museum of LA County is very excited to celebrate the 35th anniversary of the Bug Fair with all of you. For this year's Bug Fair, the museum took you on a virtual trip around the world. For this year, Bug Fair took you around the world. They share local stories from LA backyard, show up the most unique specimen from its collections, and highlighted entomologists from all over the globe and more. Bug Fair programming has been streaming live from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. today, May 15. If you miss any of today's programs or if you'd like to revisit them, please visit the NHMLA YouTube and look for the Bug Fair Connected 2021 playlist. The playlist will also be linked to the website nhm.org/bugfair. My name is Melissa Sanchez Herrera, and I'm a postdoctoral researcher at La Universidad del Rosario in Bogotá, Colombia. I'm currently the president of the Dragonfly Society of the Americas. Before we get started with our program, Encouraging Diversity in Entomology, we are going to review some housekeeping items first. Today's live program, it's available in both English and Spanish captions. To access this service, please see the link we will be adding in the chat. If you have any questions about the program, please submit those into the chat. Today's program will be approximately 60 minutes in length, and we'll try to get to as many questions as possible during and at the end of this program. So now let's start talking about entomology and diversity. So we're going to be talking with entomologists of color. So what is this? This is a collective of entomologists ranging from students, postdocs, to professors working on bugs like dragonflies, damselflies, roaches, spiders, and scorpions who are aware of the systemic barriers of Black, Indigenous, people of color participation in entomology and in science in general. We wanted to form an action group to work to remove these barriers and bring change into our disciplines. But first, let me introduce two of my fellow founding members. Let's bring in the PhD candidate, Solkatua Bondogbagwa Mafla. Hello, friend.
Hi, good to see you.
Same there. Can you tell us a little bit more about yourself and what bugs are you working on?
Yeah, so I study dragonflies and damselflies. It's in the order Odonata. I work, I'm at the Rutgers University in Newark, and I work with Dr. Jessica Ware at the American Museum of Natural History. And I'm interested in their movement, particularly the migration of some species, and why some species stay closer to home, why some go a little farther. And I'm particularly interested in tropical Odonata in the areas where my family's from, in the Philippines and Ecuador and across the Pacific.
That's awesome. Thank you, Solka. Now let's welcome Dr. Lauren Esposito.
Hey.
Hey, Lauren. How are you?
I'm great.
Awesome. Would you like to share a little about your current position and what bugs do you work on?
Sure. So I'm the curator of arachnology at the California Academy of Sciences. And what that means is that I study the variety of bugs that have eight legs instead of six. And that's arachnids, and those are things like scorpions and spiders and mites and ticks, and also a bunch of other things you've probably not heard of or don't encounter commonly because they're harder to find. My research is mostly centered around diversity on islands, and so the kinds of questions that I ask are, how did organisms get to islands in the first place? And once they did get there, what happened once they arrived? Did they stay in one island and diversify into many species, or did they hop between islands, becoming isolated as they moved from one to the next? And so I do that all over the world, although mostly in the Caribbean islands, which is where I grew up.
That is great. That's awesome. Thank you, Lauren. Well, I work on dragonflies and damselflies in the neotropics, and I'm interested also in looking at diversity patterns across different types of bugs, but mostly these damselflies is my interest. And I'm very interested in seeing how, like for the instance, the Andes mountain range and the Amazon basin have promoted all this diversification across these insects. But let's talk about a little bit more about what is our organization. So Solka, would you like to give us a quick and dirty of how did we began this collective?
Yeah, we got together as a lab family, friends and family of Dr. Ware's lab, past students, Dr. Esposito as a good close friend at the Cal Academy, and current students in the lab. And what we were challenged by the shutdown STEM Day, it was June 10th last year, by the Particles for Justice group that, you know, we had kind of felt this momentum from the murders of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and countless others before them. And what Particles of Justice was challenging STEM and academia to do was to stop our work, to stop our social media, our correspondence, and to kind of sit and think of what we could do as academics to kind of use our positions of privilege and power to bring some change to whatever area we were in. So us as a lab family, we kind of had thought, what are some of the things that we could do in the niche, the little small areas that we are in? And after coming together, we had a lot of ideas, and we thought one of the most tangible, one of the things that we could actually bring about change was to help bring in students to help fund memberships for students into entomological societies. So if cost is a barrier to, you know, a membership into a society, and if the membership to a society allows and provides certain networking and certain access to resources that you wouldn't otherwise have without that, that would be a quick and not so much quick, because we'll get to how we went there, but something that would actually change and give access to people who might not otherwise have access. So we kind of all had settled in that. We started some fundraising and spread the word, and we've had a lot of support from not just within the entomological community, but beyond, to help raise funds and to get students involved in membership in societies that they might not have otherwise.
Awesome, Solka, yes. Thank you for summing it up in so many short words of everything that happened that June 10th. But Lauren, would you like to tell us about what are the two main pillars of our organization?
Sure. So as entomologists of color has grown over the last 9 months or so, I guess it's, is it already May? Like, how is that possible?
Yeah.
Over the last 11 months, we've started to really focus what we want to accomplish as a collective. And we landed on two main pillars. And those are the two main pillars of our actions as really an activist group. The first is outreach and retention. So that's sort of, as Salka Tua was discussing, that's really like, how do you get past the barriers to STEM pathway for people of color? And one of the lowest barriers is just professional networking and mentorship. And so we came up with this plan to do a fundraiser and provide memberships to professional entomological societies for young students who are considering entomology as a career, as a way to get them in the door and start them down the path. And if they change their mind along the way, they change their mind. But if they're not getting in the door in the first place, then there's no way we're ever gonna change the face, the literal face of what entomology looks like and how it's representative of the incredible diversity of places that entomologists go to do their research all over the world. The second pillar is about retention and advocacy. So once people come in the door, how do we keep them here? And one of the ways that we're doing that is by, in addition to sponsoring professional society memberships for students, connecting them with mentors and providing them with mentorship in those professional, within the context of those professional societies. So helping them attend a meeting by paying for their meeting attendance, which for professional conferences can be really expensive. And if you're a student without access to resources necessarily, then it's something that's prohibitive and will ultimately keep you out of science, out of STEM. And so we're providing the mentorship that gets them into the society, the mentorship that keeps them in the society, and things like helping them to network with people that might share common interests with them, but they may not like feel courageous enough to talk to on their own because it's scary. Like you've heard about this person before, like in your science textbook, and you would never want to approach them because they're like this like, I don't know, scientists,
nicknames.
It seems funny to say like a famous scientist, but they are like a famous scientist. Mm-hmm. And yet mm-hmm. when you do approach them, they're actually like really incredibly friendly and nice people. So that networking is really incredibly important and oftentimes something that is a huge barrier to people of color.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Yeah. So when we started this, our initial goal when we did our fundraising was like $5,000. I think that's what we hoped to get. And then we rise until November, we had like 13,000 and we probably have more now.
I think we're close to 20,000 now. Yeah.
Yeah. We're probably close to 20,000 and we don't even have a year of mm-hmm. having this open, which is awesome. We have a sponsor approximately 200 students memberships across the country.
And I think we've sponsored like 350 total memberships to 200 students, because some of those students like are maybe interested in entomology broadly, but also like dragonfly specifically. So they might want to join two societies.
Mm-hmm. They can apply for at least three of them. And we are trying to cover not just the first year, but to keep it at least 3 years so we can work on the retention of these students across multiple years. So that's another thing that we're trying to support. We have also supported at least for the last entomological meeting of the Entomological Society of Americas, we supported at least 40 students to attend to the meeting. Even it was virtual, but that was great because it gave us like the ability to work with students even across other countries and
continents,
land masses. Mm-hmm. People were in India, some people were in Africa, and it was great.
It was amazing.
To have them and to talk to them. We have also been able to do like journal clubs where we have discussed papers, and it's awesome to have the ability to discuss them with people from different parts of the planet because their perspective across different of these issues might be completely different. So it's been great. But what about if we bring in some of our ENTO POC INSTAR students to talk to them?
Yeah.
So let's bring in Christian Liriano.
Yeah, that's me. Awesome. All right. So my name is Christian Liriano. I'm a student at the City University of New York, New York City. And my presentation is on what effect does the environment have on insect species? And cool. you might be wondering what that broad statement even means. But before I...
We're going to bring in more students before you can present. So keep it there. Hold on for 1 second. I know you really want to talk to
everybody's
us about
like
it.
Really anticipating like, this now. Everyone's like on the edge of their seat.
Yes. But let's see. Let's welcome in Stephanie Steele.
Hello.
Hey, Stephanie. Hey, Stephanie.
How's it going?
Good.
Great.
And finally, let's Vivian Peralta.
Hi, everybody.
Hey, Vivian. Hey. How are you guys?
Not bad?
Okay. We wanted to talk to you a little bit more about your experiences and your perspective about ENTO POC. So maybe Stephanie can tell us a little bit about how did you get to know of the existence of entomologists of color?
Yeah, so that's a great question. It was actually brought to my attention by my advisor, Susan Mazda. She sent me the information forwarded. I forget who sent it to her, but it was definitely down a chain and jumped on that immediately because I hadn't been involved in like national societies or even international societies before. So this was an amazing and exciting opportunity for me because finishing my degree, networking is so important.
Yeah, that's true. Thank you, Stephanie. What about you, Christian? Do you think ENTO POC has fostered your career had helped you somehow, how we have been helping you for your career. What do you think?
It helped me towards presenting today, the Bug Fest, and just gave me an opportunity to meet new people. And yeah, it was just, I found out about this initiative through Twitter. And I've never been a member of the Entomological Society of America. So this gave me an opportunity to apply. And yeah, and I got approved, which is cool.
Awesome. Thank you, Christian. What about Bibian?
Well,
how was your
me,
experience?
It's a couple of things. I think the networking part is really cool. I also gain a few mentors, and I speak with them like very often because, you know, I have a lot of questions. So it's good to have different people to talk to the team about the research, and they recommend me to talk to other people. So it's always very, you know, very great to have that support from multiple scientists that study different things, you know, so like that. Even as I'm kind of like thinking about what questions I want to ask, I can kind of, you know, ask them, like, how did they get there? How was it when they were student? How did they come to the point where they are now? And also something else too, as they mentioned before, is that being part of EntoPoC gave me like access to some of the societies that I didn't have access to before. And honestly, I didn't even know they existed at one point. And when I did know they existed, I was like, I'm a broke college student. I can't really do this. But with the support, I can finally now be a part of it. And it's great because, one, you know, now you're part of the network and part of the information. Mm-hmm. They send things to your home that you can read and kind of like participate on. And, you know, now I don't have to be left out, you know?
Mm-hmm. That is awesome. Yeah. So what about if we start, we're going to, these three wonderful INSTAR students, they're going to present a little bit of what they have been doing in their current undergraduates or in their master's students, like Stephanie. So they're going to present a little bit of their research. So why don't we start with Christian? You can start
All
talking.
Right. Let's try again.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see from the beginning. So my name is Christian Riano. I'm a student at the City University of New York, New York City. Presentation on what effect does the environment have on insect species? You might be asking what that broad statement even means. But before we get to that question, let's get into why I'm asking this question in the first place. So a year ago, I came across this paper, which asks the question I'm asking in this presentation and in this research, but in a general sense. So they basically ask, how does the environment and different factors such as plant diversity, the type of habitat such as forest or grassland affect diversity of all types of organisms and at different scales, which we will get into that in a little bit. So that's how I got into this question. So next is the two types of environmental factors that affect species: environmental heterogeneity, which is just a general term for anything environmental that affects diversity and species, and scale effects. So the umbrella term, which is the big term, environmental heterogeneity, so anything that involves the environment, so which is separated into two components, biotic and abiotic. Biotic, things that comes from living things. Abiotic, things that are not necessarily living. But for this study, we only incorporated biotic. So things like vegetation. So with vegetation, you have usually two components, the structure, plants, so such as like how tall the plant is, how much leaves does they have. It's one component. Another component is diversity, the amount of species. And second, you have something called land cover. So either the amount of land, the amount of forest, or the pretty much the amount of forest. And then or the types of terrestrial habitats, such as a forest or a grassland, that could fall under composition. So, and lastly, this study only looked at terrestrial ecosystems, so we excluded aquatic, such as streams. And then you got abiotic, which wasn't included in the study, but just to get an idea what this term means, which is just a general term. So soil, topography, and climate fall under abiotic. All right, for scale, which I'm not including in this presentation because I haven't extracted the data yet, but it's very important for this type of research. So what do you mean by scale? So you got two types of scale, grain and extent. So the grain is like the most minimal amount of information of data. So let's say you collect data on butterflies, you have a trap out. So the area, the length times the width of that first trap, then the extent, it's the all the traps combined. And another way you can look at it is from a anthropogenic, so a human perspective. So you got stand, just a bunch of trees that a forester studies. Then you also got a larger scale, which is the whole. So you got a small scale, the stand, just probably like a hectare, just a small amount of trees. And then you got a forest, larger scale. So that's another way you could look at it. So the research questions we're asking this study is, does evidence support the hypothesis that environmental heterogeneity is positively associated with species, insect species richness? What is the overall strength? How strong is the relationship? Is there variation in the relationship between different insect groups and at spatial scales? Which again, I do not have any data right now. All right, so the methods, our approach was a meta-analysis. So meta-analysis is basically a numerical analysis, statistical analysis that combines data from scientific papers to support your questions. And then you also extract something called an effect size. There are many types of effect sizes. So it's basically a measure that measures the strength between variables. But for this, we looked at a correlation effect size, so just a number that relates a dependent and an independent variable, rather than a treatment and a control, which you find most commonly, let's say, which you're probably familiar with medicine, which is where meta-analysis came from, essentially. Then Google Scholar was used as a search engine for all the papers. So these are terms that are used to describe environmental heterogeneity, different types. So I use a lot of these terms. Habitat heterogeneity is one, habitat diversity, structural complexity, vegetation structure. So as you can see, there's a lot of terms that are used by many different types of people for different purposes. So you take that into account. So the results. So, sorry about that. So this is the preliminary results. These are the left side study name. These are various papers and individual data points within papers. So they're not all independent. So as you can see, there's multiple points within the paper. So what this means, anything that goes to the right side of the middle line means there is a positive correlation. So it seems like there is a positive relationship in general for species richness with regards to the type of environmental heterogeneity, which was surprising, because I would have thought you could find at least some negative, since there's usually always an exception in science. It's kind of caught me off guard. All right, so. All right, so why does this research matter? So lots of recent studies on insect declines have provided information on why insects are declining, the causes of insect declines. So why not ask the opposite question, what causes the increase of insect species? Believe it or not, no one has summarized the literature. So another thing you could think about is conservation efforts. So let's say a forest manager wants to increase the amount of butterflies species in an area. Perhaps he could increase the amount of plant species in an area. So lastly, the next steps is to finish extracting data from other papers, including the grade and extent. And some interesting questions to ask after the grade and extent is, after we collect grade and extent is, how does grain and extent. So let's say, how does that affect the effect size, the relationship between on the right side. So I can explain it here. So it'll be interesting here. To take into account grain and effect. So at the smallest area, how does that affect the squares? So is there a relationship between how far are the squares from the middle with the grain extent? So that would be pretty interesting to ask. And that's pretty much all I have for now. Thank you for listening, and I'll hand it over to the next presenter, Stephanie.
All right, thank you, Christian. And yeah, so I am here to give you all just a little peek into some of the work that I did for my master's thesis on cavity nesting bees of Portland, Oregon. So to start us off, let's review some on pollinators in general. So animals like insects are important for pollinating many of our food crops and other flowering plants. Bees are some of our most common pollinators, but did you guys know that there's more than 4,000 species of bees just here in the US? Butterflies and moths, flies, beetles, and even wasps are important pollinating insects as well. However, recent studies, like even Christian just mentioned, they've shown that bees and other insects across the world are in decline. And so this is due to several contributing factors, such as habitat loss, which can occur through agricultural intensification and urbanization. But some ways to combat some of this loss. There's farms and gardens that are incorporating pollinator habitat back into some of their spaces, like this local farm that we see up top. And then when developing pollinator habitat, it's important to recognize the nesting sites where bees live. So the social system of honeybees on the left, where there's a queen and workers, this is not common in most species. So the majority of other bees are solitary. So about 70% of solitary bees dig tunnels in the ground to nest, whereas the other 30% of species nest in cavities, like we see with this log. And then urban habitats can support a diverse number of bees, but there needs to be adequate habitat. So nesting sites that are needed to support cavity and ground nesting bees can, however, be limited in some of these urban areas. So in addition to providing floral resources, we also need to ensure that we're incorporating nesting resources. So you want to leave some vegetation uncut, bare soil, and dead wood. And then in addition to providing natural cavity nesting sites, such as hollow plant stems and dead wood like this snag here, We can also supplement nest sites with human-constructed artificial cavities. In this example on the right is a very elaborate structure with many different types of nests for many animals. But these structures can also act as great tools for education. But a question I found myself asking about cavity nests is, how does height factor in? So yeah, nest blocks are widely accepted for studying cavity nesting bees and wasps, and they're becoming more popular in gardens like this station at a local city park on the left. However, there's been few studies that examine species height preferences. This is aside from the few commercially managed bees, like alfalfa leafcutter bees. And then generally when height is mentioned, it's often at 1.5 meters without supporting data like we see on the right. And then there's also been no studies in Portland, so we don't know what species are here or their nesting preferences. So for my research, I wanted to know what cavity nesting species are present in the Portland area, what cavity widths that they use, and the nest heights they use. So although bee and wasp species both use cavity nests, today I'm primarily just going to talk about the bee species. And so now I'll describe just briefly some of my methods. So to address my questions, 54 nest blocks were designed and built, and each of them had 31 square cavities with 5 cavity width sizes, 3, 5, 6, 8, and 10 millimeters. And then the nests were also designed to be easily disassembled so that the cavity trays could be photographed and then the occupants reared out. And then to address my question on height preference, nest blocks were attached to wooden posts with the help of volunteers at 3 experimental heights of 0.5, 1.5, and 2.3 meters. 14 locations across the greater Portland area were used to place the 54 nest blocks from this study. And so these areas sampled did represent a diverse portion of the region, and that 9 of the locations were residential gardens, and then the others were community gardens, natural areas, and 1 organic farm. For my results, question 1 addressed what species were present. And so I found 16 species of bees and 2 families used the nest blocks. So a variety of bees were present, but cavities were primarily occupied by 2 species, Megachile angularum, and then Osmia ligneria, who's commonly called the blue orchard mason bee. And then question 2 addressed what widths were used by species. Collectively for the bees, they used all 5 cavity widths, but primarily use occurred in the 2 smallest sizes. So the 5 millimeter width was used significantly more and by the greatest number of species. And then here you see some of the small bodied bees who use some of these smallest cavity widths, the 3 and 5 millimeters. Also notice all the different types of nesting material that they used. So this does expand beyond like what most folks are familiar with nesting blue orchard mason bees using mud. And then question 3 addressed what heights were used. So for the bees, all 3 nest heights were used collectively, but cavities at heights of 1.5 meters were used significantly less. However, though, approximately the same number of species used each of the 3 heights. And then from these results, we can make some conclusions. But I first need to take a little step back and address that in addition to the bees, solitary predaceous wasps also use the cavities to build their nests. And so these wasps are beneficial incidental pollinators. They also act as biological control of common garden pests like aphids, caterpillars, and crickets. And so now we can use this figure to better summarize the nest use of bee and wasp species. And so don't worry, I'm going to go over this and then we're going to use it to summarize a couple conclusions. And so along the bottom axis, we see the locations are repeated 3 times. These locations represent the 54 nest blocks at the 18 different location sites. And then along the right are the five cavity widths. Along the top are the 3 nest heights. And along the left are the number of cavities used per width size. And then lastly, the color data that you're viewing, it shows bees in green and the wasps in yellow. So a common recommendation to attract spring blue orchard mason bees to cavity nests are to place them at heights of 1.5 meters and to use cavity widths of 6 and 8 millimeters. However, if we only used these types of nests, we see that overall these parameters yielded some of the lowest occupancy rates, thus excluding the majority of the small body species that are often active in the summer season. So now if we look at what yielded the greatest number of occupants, we see that all 3 heights were used, but primarily the 2 smallest cavity widths were occupied. Therefore, these 2 smallest cavities, 3 and 5 millimeters, should be provided at greater proportions. The larger sizes are important too, 6, 8, and 10 millimeters, and they still do need to be made available. But it's often the small bees and the wasps as well that might be overlooked. And so for overall height, we see that there was no preference in use. And if we remember where natural cavity nesting sites can be found in stumps, logs, tree snags, these all occurred at varying heights. So to better accommodate Portland's cavity nesting species, found cavity size is most important. Many of the species that nested in the smaller cavities were active in the summer months, so it's important that they have nesting sites so that they can pollinate nearby summer flowers and crops. And so although this study wasn't comprehensive of all nesting species in the Portland area, we now have a much better understanding of these species and some of their nesting habits. And then finally, I just want to thank everybody who supported and funded this project, and that concludes my presentation. So I would like to introduce Vivian.
Hey. Well, hi everyone. My name is Vivian Amelia Peralta Santana, and I go to school in Rutgers University, Newark. Fun fact, you know, I'm a senior. I'll be graduating tomorrow. You know, it's kind of cool. Let's see. So today I wanted to talk to you guys about the jewel bug, you know, so I'm gonna take you guys on a little journey and then I'll let you know what I'm kind of like studying. Okay. So let's see. So the little bit of background, you know, this is the jewel bug. Well, there are different kinds, but this one is also considered like a jewel bug, right? So this is how it looks in its adult form, okay? Its scientific name is Bee Staley. And, you know, it's just black. It has little orange dots, you know, very cute, very, very cute bug. One of my favorite ones. And, you know, I just want to give you guys a little bit of background. This type of insect, you know, has different stages as it's growing up, which are called instars, you know, in its nymph stage. And look how cute they are. This is why they are called jewel bugs, because they get these shiny colors when they are young. So they're very pretty. And boom, they look like that as an adult. So this is part of something that is called incomplete metamorphosis, where, you know, as a lot of people are very familiar with complete metamorphosis, which we see in butterflies, we see it in beetles, but a lot of insects also do the opposite. They do like incomplete. They're born out of the egg in like a miniature adult form, and they kind of like change each time until they become like the fully adult, okay? And usually bugs that do this are in the family Hemiptera. So you might recognize some of its cousins that, you know, we don't like so much, you know, like the bed bug. But some other ones that are kind of, I guess, fun. I like the water strider I see a lot, or stink bugs. And so, you know, they belong in that family. And just also so you guys know at home, insects are divided in orders, and each order has their name. So the one that I'm talking about today is in the Hemiptera, which, you know, low-key is considered true bugs, and everyone else has a different name, like butterflies is Lepidoptera or dragonflies is Odonata. But, you know, in English, we just call everything a bug, so it's okay, you know. And also, this little bug lives in a shrub that, you know, grows in the desert. This is how it looks, so you guys know. Also, it is believed that it has some compounds that the insect absorbs, and that's why predators don't really bother the shrub or them. I think they only have like one known predator that attacks their eggs. But outside of that, you know, no one tries to eat them. So they live a very happy, chill life in this little shrub. But, you know, why am I telling you all this? You know, other than that, I really like them. Well, I got to visit them in Baja California a couple years ago. I believe 2 years ago. And as you see, it's kind of like in the middle of the desert. So I began to think, you know, I was like a little bit curious, like, how do they live? Like, what's up? What's going on in here? So if you see how like vegetation is very like spread out. So I was like a little bit worried, especially because near the area, like a few miles at least away from the area where I had spot them, they were building some tourist attractions, some golf fields, you know, they were building stuff. So it was kind of like, okay. And that's where I started doing this project. So the beginning, well, at least I just want to tell you guys, the dispersal might play a crucial role in the species persistence, especially for species that live in patchy environments like this one. And, you know, abundance of its plant where they live might influence, you know, their livelihood. And also, especially if there is barriers like, you know, people building things or bodies of water like a river dividing the colonies, you know, it might limit its dispersal. So I started studying them, and my hypothesis was that they might be genetically isolated and have a low dispersal ability. And I say this because when I pass a whole, like at least 2 days with them, and they seem like very chill insects. They really don't try to fly away or run, which I kind of like hypothesize maybe because they don't have that much presence of predators, so they really don't feel like fear like that. But where I saw them, there was a river, and then there was six shrubs on one side, six other shrubs in the other side, and they were like very far apart. And each shrub seemed like it had its own little colony. And, you know, in my mind, I was thinking, okay, it's near a river, but what happens if we started building around it? Like, are they able to just fly to the next shrub and live happy, or do they die with the shrub if, you know, something bad happens? So to investigate this, I collected individuals from all the shrubs and started running some DNA extractions, some PCR amplifications. And my hope was to construct a network that I will be able to kind of like analyze and see the relationship between the individuals that live in the shrubs with each other in the same shrub or with the others to see, you know, their local population. And this is kind of like the sad part. COVID, the pandemic hit right when I was doing the PCR, when I was running the PCR sequencing and amplifications. So I couldn't really continue. So I low-key have to give you guys the update about what happened. But hopefully in the future, I will be able to like finally finish, you know, and see what happened. But at least I wanted to leave you guys with a thought that, you know, human development in the area might decrease the population of the shrub, and which will create longer distances between the shrubs that are already existing there in those areas. And that, you know, disturbances in, especially in insects that have this specialized relationship with their host plant, you know, the disturbances might decline the organism's survival. And I just kind of wanted to like really like have you guys understand that by us understanding the relationships that these insects have with their plants and with us, we can take better responsible action, you know, in preserving them and kind of like understanding what happens if we move into their space, you know? So this is kind of like where I want to leave you guys. I hope you enjoy my presentation. And, you know, I just wanted to give some thanks to a couple people, especially the Wear Lab, where, you know, everybody's been supporting me in my scientific dreams, and also Bugfair for inviting me to speak today. Thank you so much. And I will hand it now to Melissa.
Thank you, Vivian. That was a great presentation of these beautiful true bugs. So we're going to invite everybody else in for having some questions from the audience. So maybe we can answer some of the questions that the audience have for us. So that was a great talk, guys. Congratulations for those wonderful research questions.
Thank you.
So let's see. We have some questions for all of us. So one of the first questions that we have is, what first got you interested in entomology, and what advice do you all have for many future entomologists hoping to join this field? So who wants to start? What about Lauren?
Me? Well, I don't know. I mean, I think like for all the kids that might be out there watching right now, I was into bugs when I was a kid. I think I was an entomologist already back then, right? Like I would go in the garden and I would like flip over the pots, which was not something anyone was excited about, but I was excited because underneath them there was like pill bugs and earwigs and cockroaches, which I didn't know any better. I thought they were exciting. And crickets and all sorts of things that, like, I think a lot of people are grossed out by, but I was like, oh, this is so cool. So I wasn't into the, like, pretty butterflies and bees. I was into, like, the creepy crawly stuff that was living underground. And I think I kind of carried that with me, like, my whole life. And when I started college and took entomology class, I was like, oh, I remember how much I love insects and collecting insects. That was the beginning of the end for me.
That was the beginning of being an entomologist. What about Stephanie?
I would have to also agree that my passion started at a young age. I was fortunate to grow where I grew up. I lived near like a creek. I lived near a relatively large forested area within Cincinnati, and go down to the creek and go creeking, flipping over rocks and looking for stuff in the river, looking for things like in the woods, on the trails. So that kind of sparked it. But once I entered like junior high school and like high school, my school is a little alternative. It's a public Montessori school. And so we had different types of clubs. We had a bee club. We had honeybees. I think at one point we had 6 hives on the roof of our school. Oh. And so our chemistry teacher, he led the group and taught us about beekeeping. And so that kind of like really sparked it for me. But then once I moved out to Oregon and met up with Susan Masta, learned about the diversity of native bees that we have here that's so vast and also so little is known. But yeah, I'm hooked.
Christian, like you live in New York City. What got you into entomology? Like, I'm dying to know.
It's actually it's a great question. So when I was 17, I got into just science, popular science. And I came across a book by Edward O. Wilson, who studies ants. So he got me interested in nature and stuff. But then when I was like 19 or so, I started to collect data on upstate, on amphibians, salamanders, and toads, just the distribution and ecology of frogs, toads, and salamanders. Then when I was like 21, that's when I got interested in insects. And that's how it started off for me. Then just recently, not just insects, other arthropods too, especially spiders and daddy long legs, like as well. So That's pretty much how I branched out from frogs to insects.
Well, like, yeah. They go hand in hand.
Yeah.
Vivian, you're in Jersey. You're just across the water, also in a really urban area. How did you find your way to insects?
Oof, let me tell you guys. So I grew up in the Dominican Republic, so bugs and me were best friends already, you know. They're, like, very common. Like, so, you know, like, I used to,
hey.
So I didn't know the difference between moths and butterflies for, like, my whole life. So I used to raise moths thinking they were butterflies. And, like, you know, like, release them and things like that. Thought it was very fun. We used to get them from, like, pigeon peas, I think, chickpeas. I don't know. So I used to keep all the caterpillars, feed them, and then, like, you know, take care of them. But anyways, after I got older, I really was looking into, like, studying animals because my mom's dream was to be a vet. So I was like, you know what? I like animals. Let's do that. But and then as I got older, I kind of started gravitating back into insects. And, you know, I'm in college. I'm like, I want to join a lab. I want to learn some science. Like, let me join an animal lab. But on my way to the animal lab, low-key, like, two things happened. One, I saw a dragonfly. And two, I got an invitation to join a class about tropical biology where Dr. Ware and Salka was at. So you already know it was fate. Like, they just wanted me. I just went and ended up there. And I'm like, yo, this is great. And I've been there ever since.
Yeah, and it was actually at Islands and Seas at Dr. Esposito's biostation. That was where we had the class, and the rest is history. That's where you collected the, that's where Vivian was able to collect the true bugs.
Mm-hmm.
That is a great story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm glad I was a part of it.
It's all connected there.
It's all connected. I'm telling you, it was fate. Like, it was destined for me.
That's awesome. What about you, Salka?
Yeah, you're like from like around LA, greater LA region, right? That's where you grew up?
Yeah, that's home. Well, that's one of the homes because my father was in the Air Force. So I was born in LA, but my mom's from the Philippines. My dad's from Ecuador. And I attribute them with not instilling stories in me that made me afraid of insects or spiders. The stories that my mom would tell when we were little, were from when she was little, to us, so that she loved catching dragonflies and damselflies around the creeks, kind of like what Stephanie said. She grew up and there was a river by her village in the Philippines. So a lot of her childhood was just collecting out in the water and collecting. And my dad would tell me funny stories of, growing up in like Riobamba and Guayaquil, that there was a lot of scorpions. There was always scorpions somewhere, and they were like so curious and it seemed so dangerous. But, you know, the way they told the story was more out of an interest in like trying to see what these things do rather than, oh, I get stung and it really hurt, which I'm sure he did. Like, I don't know how he would have probably been able to avoid it. So I really am thankful that they gave us stories that were like beautiful, inspiring things rather than fear. It, you know, don't do this, don't touch these things. And as I grew up and I found my way through bio, I just sought out teachers who are like, is there an opportunity for me to study anything? I just wanted to learn about as much of the diversity of life as I could. So in community college, I studied snails. In my undergrad, I studied bats. And I was able to study them in Ecuador, but it was interesting. They would always kind of bring me back to an invertebrate. And I was studying bats and their diet, which they mostly in that area ate a lot of insects. And it was on another tropical field class, just like Vivian's. But when I was in my undergrad, my mentor at the University of Missouri in St. Louis was Dr. Bourne, and he was doing a project with Dr. Ware. And when we did that class in Guyana, I was able to like go out with her team and collect with her. And after collecting, or after working with mammals and seeing how difficult it was to collect the individuals that you're looking for, the particular species you're looking for, but going out with entomologists, you would go out for just maybe an hour or two and you come back with so much different little insects. And I was in my head, as I was trying to think of like, what will my next step be? Understanding, you know, my head was thinking about data all the time. So understanding that this was so much more data than I had with the mammals, I was like, oh, this is where I need to be. And thank goodness I had a mentor like Dr. Bourne that said, I think you should probably consider this path. Like, don't go any other path you're thinking, and he didn't steer me wrong. And Dr. Ware was nice enough to take a chance on somebody crazy like me that's like, oh, I like it. These insects, there's a lot of them. Like, what can I do? How can I study the different kinds? So,
well, and Melissa, yeah. Like, you grew up in the heart of it all, and like the heart of diversity, yeah. Really.
Yeah, I grew up in
Colombia. Did that influence you?
Definitely. I mean, I grew up in Colombia, but I grew up in Bogota, which is a big city. It's cold, so the diversity is not as high, but you know, you can travel probably 2 hours towards the valleys of our mountain range, and then you're like burning 40 Celsius degrees in a, like, my God, and then the bugs all are over you. But I remember when I was a kid, there is like around April, May, there's like rainy season, and it's when all the beetles comes out from the ground. It's like this massive thing that happens in Bogota, which is the same kind of little beetle all over. But then I remember when I was a kid that there was this time of the year when I will go out to the park and there's like all these things going on out and I was catching them. But my mom was very afraid of them because my terrible uncles like to put them in their hair when she was a kid and they tangled them. So she was like always like, oh my God, how do you can touch that? And I was like, but it was like, I'm trying to save them, but you know, they usually turn up, yeah, and they're like that. So I was saving them when I was a kid. And I think it's also because when you're a kid, you're closer to them. So you're able to see them more than maybe when you're an adult, you kind of forget about them. And then I always love biology. And when I travel all around Colombia, you know, you will see all these animals and these bugs and everything. And I decided to become a biologist because here our career paths are a little different. Here, when you decide to become a biologist, you know you're going to study diversity. You're not doing biology major for maybe becoming a vet or maybe becoming a doctor. There is like completely different paths. And I became a biologist, and then I always loved more animals than plants. I mean, they're great. I love them. They're beautiful, but they don't bring all that passion to me. Not at all.
They don't fly.
No, they don't do it. I mean, they do great stuff. I now I love them more, but I still love more animals. So I really like vertebrates, and I was like teaching, I said like a peer tutor for vertebrate class for, I don't know, 2 or 3 years. But I went to a field trip to one of the national parks to work with microinvertebrates, like do sampling across rivers. And then I got to dragonflies, and they were like, this is so much fun. They are fun, they are beautiful, they are big, they are challenging to catch. So it's like every time that you actually catch one, you're like, yes, I did it. And it's so much diversity here. And then I started to realize there's not too many things known about the diversity of the neotropics in dragonflies. And that's how I started. And I have been working on them since 2005. And I still describing species and getting to know so many incredible things. So definitely just having the curiosity, keeping it alive, being amazed every time that you go out into the field, even for the smallest thing that you see walking at your house, even if you are outside. Just, you know, I think that's, if someone wants to become a biologist and entomologist, just become amazed with those little stuff. That's what keeps you going, and it's amazing. So yeah.
And I think, you know, you brought up like a really interesting point that is exactly something that I don't think most people in the world realize, which is that there's still so much left to be discovered when it comes to entomology and insects. Like you said, you're still describing species. Like I think most professional entomologists can say that they've described and discovered new species. And that's still the case. There's so much work left to be done. Like there's so many things left to document, and you can do that. Like you can become an entomologist and describe and discover new species whenever you want.
There's so many places that we haven't been able to look at. And now even more, every time that we have more technology, there's more places that we can reach out and discover.
That actually brings up like a question I saw in the chat about travel, which is like, do you get to travel? And I know, like, first I want to say like big up to the students that presented. Like, those presentations were amazing. I don't know if everyone out there realizes that like two of these folks are undergraduates, although Vivian formally graduated yesterday. Is that what you said yesterday?
Tomorrow, mañana.
Tomorrow. And Stephanie just finished her master's like yesterday. You too, Christian, you graduate tomorrow?
No, I got a year and a half. I have a long history of school. It's
crazy. Hey, no worries. But Stephanie, you graduated like yesterday or something. You finished your master's.
Yeah, I defended last week, but graduation will come in a few more weeks.
All right.
Yeah.
But travel's like a part of the game. And it's not always like when you're a student, I think like you don't always get to travel as much as later in your career, but Melissa, Salkatua, I know the two of you have traveled all over. You want to like talk a little bit about how that has influenced your like choice in this career?
Sure. I mean, traveling is a bit, I mean, I think I've traveled everywhere where dragonflies have taken me. Either collecting, which is the funnest. I mean, when they ask me the question of what do you prefer more, lab, field work? Field work is like 60% of the things that I like. I cannot say that I do not enjoy the lab because I do molecular work and I kind of like to see like DNA and things amplifying and seeing all this hidden stuff that we have. But field work, I mean, I've been in wonderful. One of my things that I wanted is to see every South American country being there. And I have been able to see a lot because of dragonflies. So I have been traveling to Ecuador, to Peru, to Argentina. I'm missing Chile, Venezuela. I went to Guyana, which I went with Stefan, like the Wear Lab. But I also traveled all other places because of conference. So being able to go out and network with people from different countries, like in the UK, in Germany, even sometimes we can go to like Japan or things like that. You know, it's amazing to just see how much more you can travel just because you're going to talk about these wonderful organisms. Who would have thought that there's someone out there in, I don't know, miles from you that is interested about the same kind of organism and is super excited to hear you talk about your fauna in your country? Because is that mainly what I do, talk about the neotropical fauna. So it's super cool. And there's been stories all over, you know, things that happen in the field work, which is also a lot of fun. Things that sometimes is like, oh my God, how did I do that? But I mean, that's part of the job, and it's great, you know, to be part of being able to be with communities, talk to different people within the communities, get them excited about their fauna, what they have. Oh, I probably think that everyone that knows me remembers me because of a dragonfly. So, or they will remember dragonflies because I talk to them about them.
Yeah.
So that's super cool to do around the world. What about you, Solka?
I think the part for me that the science, the travel with this work has been super, just so pivotal in my life is that a lot of history has kind of taught us like that we had to leave our countries to find value. So through colonialism, my family's from the Philippines and from Ecuador. So we had to leave those places to find opportunities, right? But through our science, especially in entomology, we know we have a lot of the greatest diversity of insects in the tropics. And as an Ecuadoriana, I'll compete with you, Melissa, in Colombia. We have some of the greatest diversity in the world, in Ecuador and in the Philippines. And because I've had a lot of support, I have mentors who have helped me to be able to study our fauna in our country, in our countries, right? And I think that's a unique position that diaspora students, people that are living and studying in the States, but are still connected to your ancestral lands, your homelands, if you travel. I think that's a really beautiful thing that you can bring to the science. That, you know, at one point it might have seemed like there was no value in your people or your home. And this science in particular tells us there's so much value in those places. And I'm thankful every day that I get to study the insects, the diversity that's in my country. So that for me has been like the most beautiful thing I've been able to accomplish through this work.
I think, like, I have one more question for everybody. This is an easy one. Okay. It's, what's your favorite bug? And I say bug like this, like, okay, we all know that bugs can be really broad and include things that maybe aren't traditionally regarded by professional entomologists as bugs. So we could do like a popcorn style. So I'm going to hand it off to Vivian first. And you're muted, Vivian.
Yeah, I got it. So let me see. So I really like shield bugs, but moths have a big place in my heart because, you know, everyone likes their pretty cousin, the butterflies. And, you know, I just kind of, I appreciate moths. You know, they're pretty too.
I feel like that's good. And I would just say that moth people would say that butterflies are just colorful moths. So, hey.
Yep. True. I will pass it over to, let me see, popcorn to Christian.
Beetles, specifically rove beetles. Mm-hmm. Specific mm-hmm. type of beetle. Yeah, that's, I guess. I love all bugs, thing, non-insects, like spiders, that are long legs. So it's, yeah, it's a very hard question. Collect them all. But to be honest, except I'm going to collect dragonflies and damselflies, because they're very hard to keep. So I ignore collecting those. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
You want to pass it to somebody?
Oh, pass it on.
Oh, we lost you for the moment where you said someone's name.
Pass. Pass it over to Stephanie.
Oh, all right.
Okay.
Yeah. I keep freezing. I don't know why. Sure.
All right. So, favorite bugs. I mean, of course, I have to say bees, but just. Then say one, I don't think I can, but I can at least narrow it down.
You have to.
I can narrow it down to a family and say that the Megachelidae family of bees is my favorite. So that's who I primarily was studying within the cavity nest. They're really beautiful.
What's the common name of those bees?
I mean, their name translates to like big jaw, big lips. So they're known for their large mandibles. There's basin bees, leafcutter bees in that family, but lots of others as well. I really like them because they have, at least those that collect pollen, their scopa, their pollen collecting hairs is on their ventral abdomen. So they just get covered, like their whole body gets covered, and it's really beautiful. I'll pass it to Melissa.
So I'm completely biased with damselflies. So Polythor damselflies are my favorite. Those are banner wings. They have a lot of wing colors. They look actually like butterflies. So those are my favorite species. But I have to say that I love orchid bees.
Yeah,
I've never seen those in person, but I've seen photos and videos and their legs. Oh my goodness, their hind legs and their proboscis,
absolutely beautiful. And if you actually catch them and see them, they are like
wow,
amazing. Mm-hmm. What about Solka?
I do love moths. I love a lot of the nocturnal ones. Some of the behaviors they have to avoid bats and some of the nectivorous ones with really long proboscis, they're amazing. But the dragonflies have caught my heart, particularly the migratory ones. I feel like a kinship with them since my family has migrated all over the world. The ones that move really far and they're just, you know, looking for resources, trying to survive and reproduce, I feel something for them. So I love them. And Lauren, what do you think?
That just leaves me. Well, I mean, I feel like I should follow, like, be true to my study organisms and say some kind of scorpion, but I'm not going to say that because actually, like, my secret love of bugs is roaches. I think they're so cute. They're like really adorable, and they just like, they're super clean, even though people think they're really dirty. And like, there's so many species of roaches that you like would never find except in like a super pristine environment that hasn't been impacted by humans. And so I love roaches. And so many of them are so beautiful, like green and striped and polka dotted and all kinds of crazy stuff you wouldn't imagine.
Some of them mimic beetles, like click beetles.
Yeah, yeah.
They are so amazing. Yeah.
Oh my God, guys, also, when you're bored, look up the Picasso bug. So you can see something pretty. And the rosy maple moth. Okay.
You know, those are
beautiful insects.
Okay, people, I think we are a little bit strengthening our schedule. So I want to thank you all the speakers. Thank you to all our audience for joining us in this program. With the Bug Fair moving online, key participants in the Bug Fair experience have been missing the exhibitors. No Bug Fair is complete without these amazing individuals and organizations, many of whom have been part of these events for 30 years. These exhibitors range from face painting, educational toys, insect specimens, and pinwheels. We'd like to give them a shout out here at the Bug Fair Connected by giving them some time to say hello. Let's take a look at one now.
Hi, I'm Robin M. Cohen, and I've been face painting at the Bug Fair for 10 years. People will find two painters in my booth who will decorate their face or arms with spiders, butterflies, or anything else they'd like. We finish the designs with glitter and gems. I also bring my art prints for purchase. Bug Fair is amazing. There is so much fun to be had wandering the halls, petting silkworms and holding scorpions, buying and tasting honey, and even learning how to make your own backyard a haven for monarch butterflies.
Thank you, Robin. That concludes our program and concludes the 35th year of Bug Fair. To view today's program, please visit the NHMLA YouTube and take a look for the Bug Fair Connected 2021 playlist. The playlist will also be linked to the website of the museum, nhm.org/bugfair. Thank you again for joining us. It was a great time.